The following content is provided under a Creative Commons license. Your support will help MIT OpenCourseWare continue to offer high-quality educational resources for free. To make a donation or view additional materials from hundreds of MIT courses, visit MIT OpenCourseWare at ocw.mit.edu.
Hi, I'm Sal. Today we're going to be solving problem 1 of exam 3 of fall 2009. Now, before you attempt the problem, there's a couple of things that you should know or have background knowledge of this material before starting. First thing is understanding the properties of crystal defects. And for this problem, particularly Frankel defects, which we'll talk about, the formula, which is an Arrhenius relationship as a function of temperature and energy, enthalpy, of the fraction of vacancies that are formed in a crystal, and the conversion again between 1 electron volt and 2 to the joule. This will help you solve the problem. So the problem reads as follows. Silver bromide, which is AgBr, has rock salt crystal structure. So it's an FCC Bravais lattice with the ion pair Ag plus and the Br as the basis, Br minus as the basis. The dominant defect in AgBr or silver bromide is the Frankel disorder. So it's telling you that what the dominant defect is. So the question asks for part A, so I'll put A here. Part A for the question asks, does the Frankel disorder in silver bromide create vacancies of silver plus, vacancies of Br minus, or both? Explain. The ionic radii are 0.67 angstroms for silver plus and 1.96 angstroms for bromine minus. So that's data that's given to us, so I'm going to go ahead and write that down. So I know from reading and about point defects in crystals that a Frankel defect is pretty much formed when you have an ion pair of dissimilar sizes. So if one of the radii is, like say your anion, it's a lot bigger than the radius of your cation, then one should expect that you would have a Frankel defect to form. And what a Frankel defect is, which you should know from reading the material, is that it's when one of the ions in your crystal leaves back a vacancy. So just migrates, just hops out of its lattice site and leaves back empty space. It's just called the vacancy. So we're given two things. So if I draw a little picture, I can call this my silver, and I'll call this my bromine. And I'm given the fact that the radius of Ag plus is equal to 0.67 angstroms. And an angstrom is just 10 to the minus 10 meters, very small number. And I'm also given that the radius of bromine, the anion, is 1.96 angstroms. Now, I would argue that these two have very dissimilar radii. Obviously, the bromine looks to be about 3 times bigger than your silver. So by understanding the definition of a Frankel defect, I can claim that that I would expect the smaller ion of the two to be the one that leaves the vacancy behind, hence forms the Frankel defect. So for part A, do I expect it to create silver plus vacancies or Br minus vacancies or both? I would expect just to be silver plus, given the size of your cation. So if you were to write on this problem, expect only Ag plus, which is your silver cation, or the smaller one. I'll write that down. The expect Ag plus smaller ion to create a vacancy, and hence this leads to a Frankel defect. So yes, I should expect it to form a defect. Now, if I was given a cation that had a similar radius of that, I wouldn't know if I could argue the fact that this will form a Frenkel defect or not, because the conditions are that you have to have the similar radius of between your cation and your anion. And it makes sense because, you know, the fact that your silver is small, you know, it has more freedom to hop around. So it requires less energy for this smaller atom to then start hopping around your lattice site without penalty or without major penalty compared to your bromine atom ion. So therefore, this is the one that should be expected to form that. Okay, so that's part A. And part B reads, calculate the temperature at which the fraction of Frenkel defects in a crystal of silver bromide exceeds 1 part per billion. The enthalpy of Frenkel defects of formation, delta H sub F, has a value of 1.16 electron volts per defect. And the entropic prefactor A has a value of 3.091. So it's giving you data. Now, the way I will solve this problem is that the first thing I would do is that I would write down what my data is. So I'll call this data. And the first thing is that our fraction of vacancies that are formed in silver bromide is 1 part per billion, so 10 to the minus 9. That's a fraction, so no units. The second thing that we're given in the problem is that our energy of formation, our enthalpy energy, it's 1.16 electron volts per defect. This is the energy penalty for every time one of your silver cations jumps out of sight to create that. Nothing is free, everything requires energy. We're also given the fact that A, the entropic prefactor, is 3.091 with no units. And given our equation that I showed you on my bullet on the bullet point that you should know, you can go ahead and see what's missing. So if I write out my equation, you know, this is all, I'll box this off as my data, because I'm going to refer to this to solve the problem. And the problem talks about temperature. So I know that F sub V is going to equal to just the prefactor times the exponent of negative delta H of formation over KB T. Now you notice that KB wasn't given to you, and KB is Boltzmann's constant. Now, a lot of students forget that they have a table of constants in front of them, and that value is in there. So if you don't know it by heart, then you know you want to make sure that you reference to that table, if because a lot of information won't be given to you because you're expected to look at the table of constants or your periodic table. But you know, if I include this as my data, I'm going to go ahead and write it over here that, you know, KB has a value of 1.38 times 10 to the minus 23. And this has units of joules per degree Kelvin. So this is something that you should pay particular attention to, because now KB is in joules per Kelvin, but our energy was given in electron volts. Now this is the number one thing that will take off points. You'll get points taken off if you don't notice this, that you need to go ahead and do the conversion from electron volts to joules or joules to electron volts. Either which way, you're going to get the answer. But the problem asks, calculate the temperature, the very first sentence. So what does that mean? Well, I'm going to go ahead and look at my equation, and I'm going to look at the data that I have and the constants and see if I'm missing anything else. Because obviously, you can't solve an equation that has two unknowns in just one equation. You solve the equation, you gotta only have one unknown for the equation. So F sub V, you know, check, you know, that's given. Is A given? It's right here. That's given as well. What about delta H sub F? Well, that's the energy that, you know, that the energy penalty to create a defect. And KB, which we got from our table of constants, and T. So this concludes that the only thing we're not given is temperature, because that's what we're asked to solve. So I need to do some math on here to go ahead and solve for temperature. And the first thing I want to do is take the natural log of both sides. So by taking the natural log of both sides, so natural log of F sub V, this equals to natural log of A plus the natural log of the exponent part. And we know from math that, you know, the natural log of an exponent cancels each other out because they're inverses. So the natural log, you know, of exponent of negative delta H sub F of or over KB T, this cancels that, and we just get natural log of A plus negative, because, you know, you have a negative up here, delta H of formation divided by KB T. So the only thing we don't know here is temperature. So if I can rearrange this equation and solve for temperature, I can get an answer. So if I do that, what's the best way of doing that? Well, I can move this to the other side and move this to the other side. And that gives me delta H sub F divided by KBT equals natural log of A minus natural log of your vacancy fraction. And I can then multiply both sides by T so that it cancels this one and it arises over here. And then divide both sides by ln of A. So I'll go ahead and do that. So I'll multiply this by T. Multiply that by T. So that cancels that. And I end up having delta HF over KBT. Oh, no, sorry, not T. The T got canceled. This equals to natural log of A minus the natural log of your vacancy fraction times T. So now, if I divide both sides by this factor, I solve for temperature. So this gives me a nice relation that, you know, T ends up being delta H F over KB times the natural log of A minus the natural log of your vacancy fraction. And all we have to do is plug in the numbers. But again, if you look at the units of Boltzmann's constant, which are joules per Kelvin, and the value that we're given up here is, you know, electron volts per defect, we want to go ahead and convert, you know, the electron volt to the joule, because it'll just be easier to do the math that way. So I can go ahead and write it out, and I do that by multiplying the top by that conversion factor. And, you know, if I do the math, T ends up being that we have 1.16, and this has units of electron volts per defect. Sorry that you can't see that. That's electron volts per defect. And then I want to get joules, because that's what Boltzmann's constant has. So in order to get joules, if I multiply this by the conversion factor, which is 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19, this has units of joules per electron volt. Now the electron volts cancel, and I get the numerator has units of joules per defect. And that's good, because that's going to cancel with the units in Boltzmann's constant. And then, you know, I put in 1.38 times 10 to the minus 23. This is joules per Kelvin. And, you know, this factor is multiplied by the natural log of 3.091 minus the natural log of 10 to the minus 9. So, unitless. So if you do the math out, you end up getting a value that, you know, at the end of the day, your temperature, this T right here, will be equal to, let's go ahead and write it over here. So now that we go ahead and do the math, that way it's nice and clean, we know that the temperature that we got from plugging all that, solving all that math, ends up being just 600 and 15 Kelvin. And where did the Kelvin come from? Well, it came from your joules per Kelvin, from your Boltzmann's constant, because that's what the dimensional analysis does. So, you know, this is the answer. This is good. The problem doesn't say, you know, show the answer in degrees Celsius, but, you know, since everybody knows degrees Celsius, everybody in science relies on degrees Celsius, you can just convert this over to the degree Celsius, which happens to be 342 degrees Celsius. So this right here is your answer to part B. And again, I want to express again that the crucial part in getting this is knowing the fact that you're given an energy in electron volts, but the constant that you use has units of joules. So you need to convert to get the right unit out, or else you would get not Kelvin, you would get something different here, which wouldn't make any sense given the question that was asked. So with that, again, I advise that always read the problem in detail, look at the units that you know that you're working with, and make the appropriate conversions, because everything should be on your table of constants.